Welcome to Church on the Farm, our harvest service for this, the 20th Sunday after Trinity. As we think about harvest, let's call to mind the words Jesus spoke to his disciples, taken from John chapter 4, verses 35 to 36. Jesus says this, "I tell you, open your eyes and look at the fields. They are ripe for harvest. Even though the one who reaps draws a wage and harvests a crop for eternal life, so that the sower and the reaper may be glad together." So as we think about harvest, let's remember that there is eternal harvest, which we're all working for, in the church and outside of the church. And we're going to have a Psalms now that actually relates to the goodness of God, which is going to be read for us by Sylvia.
Psalm 65. Praise awaits you, our God, in Zion. To you our vows will be fulfilled. You who answer prayer, to you all people will come. When we were overwhelmed by sins, you forgave our transgressions. Blessed are those you choose and bring near to live in your courts. We are filled with the good things of your house, of your holy temple. You answer us with awesome and righteous deeds, God our Saviour, the hope of all the ends of the earth and of the farthest seas, who formed the mountains by your power, having armed yourself with strength, who stilled the roaring of the seas, the roaring of their waves, and the turmoil of the nations. The whole earth is filled with awe at your wonders. Where morning dawns, where evening fades, you call forth songs of joy. You care for the land and water it. You enrich it abundantly. The streams of God are filled with water to provide the people with grain, for so you have ordained it. You drench its furrows and level its ridges. You soften it with showers and bless its crops. You crown the year with your bounty, and your carts overflow with abundance. The grasslands of the wilderness overflow. The hills are clothed with gladness. The meadows are covered with flocks, and the valleys are mantled with grain. They shout for joy and sing. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Sylvia. Let's pray a harvest prayer of thanksgiving. Heavenly Father, your good and your mercies endure forever.
We give thanks to you, Lord, for you are good and your faithful love endures forever.
For the breath we breathe every day. For the food you provide for us every day.
We give thanks to you, Lord, for you are good and your faithful love endures forever.
For the clothes we wear, for a place to rest our heads, for your gifts to us day by day.
We give thanks to you, Lord, for you are good and your faithful love endures forever.
For our good friends, for our children, for our family and loved ones, for those near and far.
We give thanks to you, Lord, for you are good and your faithful love endures forever.
For our church, for Jesus Christ our Lord and Savior, for the salvation that belongs to you only, and for your Holy Spirit to guide us, for your never-ending love season after season.
We give thanks to you, Lord, for you are good and your faithful love endures forever. Father God, give us hearts of gratitude, which is ever and always thankful for the giver and thankful for the one who has always provided. Amen.
And let's sing together, all creatures of our God and King. We come to a time of confession. Psalms 32 verse 1 says this: Blessed is the one whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. So let's confess our sins now to God and before one another. God our Father, we are sorry for the times when we have used your gifts carelessly and acted ungratefully. Hear our prayer, and in your mercy, forgive us and help us. We enjoy the fruits of the harvest, but sometimes forget that you have given them to us. Father, in your mercy,
forgive us and help us.
We belong to a people who are full and satisfied, but ignore the cry of the hungry. Father, in your mercy,
forgive us and help us.
We are thoughtless and do not care enough for the world you have made. Father, in your mercy,
forgive us and help us.
We store up goods for ourselves alone, as if there were no God and no heaven. Father, in your mercy,
forgive us and help us.
And the assurance of forgiveness that God forgives us, we go back to Psalms 32. And it says this: Then I acknowledged my sin to you and did not cover up my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgression to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin. Amen. Let's sing a song which really transfers those words into song. Let's sing together.
I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were condemned. And Spirit is within me because you died and rose again. I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. Amazing love, and I know it's true. forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. Spirit is within me because you died and rose again.
Today's gospel reading is taken from Matthew chapter 22, verses 34 to 46, and I'll be read for us by Rose.
Today's gospel comes from the book of Matthew, chapter 22, verse 34 to 46. Hearing that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees, the Pharisees got together. One of them, an expert in the law, tested him with this question. "Teacher, which is the greatest command in the law?" Jesus replied, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second one is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments." While the Pharisees were gathered together, Jesus asked them, "What do you think about the Messiah? Whose son is he?" "The son of David," they replied. He said to them, "How is it then that David, speaking by the Spirit, calls him Lord? For he says, 'The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I put your enemies under your feet.' If then David calls him Lord, how can he be his son?" No one could say a word in reply. And from that day on, no one dared to ask him any more questions. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
And so let us share in the collect for this, the 20th Sunday after Trinity. We say together, O mighty and most first merciful God, of your bountiful goodness, keep us, we beseech you, from all things that may hurt us, that we, being ready both in body and soul, may cheerfully accomplish those things that you would have done through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And our New Testament reading is taken from 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 6 to 15, and Anne will be reading for us.
Remember this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to bless you abundantly, so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. As it is written, they have freely scattered their gifts to the poor, their righteousness endures forever. Now he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will also supply and increase your store of seed and will enlarge the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in every way so that you can be generous on every occasion. And through us, your generosity will result in thanksgiving to God. This service that you perform is not only supplying the needs of the Lord's people, but is also overflowing in many expressions of thanks to God. Because of the service by which you have proved yourselves, others will praise God for the obedience that accompanies your confession of the gospel of Christ, and for your generosity in sharing with them and with everyone else. And in their prayers for you, their hearts will go out to you because of the surpassing grace God has given you. Thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Anne. And now Bob will give us his thought of the day from that very passage, 2 Corinthians 9.
We may be called church on the farm, but traditional harvest festivals have little in common with Broadwater Farm Estate. Sylvia may have fruit from our garden in our freezer, but how many others of you do? And we certainly don't have milk from our own cows or make bread with our own grain. This is why I'm preaching on this passage from 2 Corinthians. Corinth was no rural village. It was a busy port city with a really sleazy reputation on account of all the bars and sex workers for visiting sailors. A couple of centuries before, the Romans had defeated Corinth and wiped out its Greek population. It was resettled with people from all over the Roman Empire, making it one of the most cosmopolitan cities of its time, just like London. Paul may talk about sowing and reaping, but most of the congregation in Corinth would have had as little actual experience of such things as most of us. And like us, they were a church of ordinary people. As Paul writes in his first letter to the Corinthians, brothers and sisters, think of what you were when you were called. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were influential. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. God chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong. God chose the lowly things of this world and the despised things, and the things that are not, to nullify the things that are, so that no one may boast before him. Yet Paul writes to these people who appear to have little going for them, to encourage them to give, to help others who had even less. Fellow believers facing starvation in a famine elsewhere. Why does he say they should do that? Most basically, Christians should be people of generosity because that is how Jesus treated all of us. As Paul says in the preceding chapter, you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sake he became poor, so that you, through his poverty, might become rich. He emptied himself of the glory of heaven to die for us on the cross. In this chapter, he also appeals to self-interest, but that still reflects the teaching of Jesus, who says in Luke chapter 6, give and it will be given to you. A good measure, pressed down, shaken together and running over, will be poured into your lap. For with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. In the same way, Paul says, they have freely scattered their gifts to the poor, their righteousness endures forever. Now he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will also supply and increase your store of seed and will enlarge the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in every way so that you can be generous on every occasion. And through us, your generosity will result in thanksgiving to God. If you want God to be generous to you, he says, you need to be generous to others in need. Note, incidentally, that this is not the so-called prosperity gospel. I've sometimes seen pictures of preachers appealing to people to put more money in the offering and saying, God will make you rich like me so you can drive around in big cars too. That is garbage. It's a perversion of the gospel of Jesus. Paul here isn't asking them to give money to him, but to give it to others in need. And he's not saying God will make you rich. He's saying God will meet your needs. So, what does it mean to have a harvest celebration? We don't live near a real farm and cannot thank God for giving us our crops while showing them off to other people, as seems to be the case in traditional churches. Firstly, our harvest celebration should be a celebration of sharing. Even though most of the Corinthian believers had little themselves, they still shared with others. This is what our church does anyway, acting as a food bank for those who need it, feeding the children who come to club, for example. Let us thank God for enabling us to do that and pray that we may continue to find ways to do it with present government restrictions. Secondly, it needs to be a celebration of spiritual harvest. At the beginning of the service, we heard Jesus speaking of a spiritual harvest to be reaped. And Paul here also uses harvest as a picture of evangelism. We sow the good news of Jesus and harvest disciples. Yet we can only sow spiritually what we ourselves have received from God. You might feel you are not up to such spiritual work, but if you step out in faith and give spiritually to others, then you can pray to and trust God to replenish your spiritual resources, that you might continue to give out spiritual aid to those who need it, and the church may reap a great spiritual harvest. Thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. Amen.
Thank you, Bob. And as we think of those words, we think of, it's not about the little that you have. It's about what you do with the little that you have. And God always blesses a cheerful giver. Let's sing together. Give thanks with a grateful heart. And now let's affirm our faith as one church, one people. We say together the creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And so we come to a time of prayer where we pray, and Hethi will pray with us and for us.
Peace. Lord, we your people pray that we be a harvest worthy to be yours. We pray for the church, that we here, members, be gathered as the harvest is gathered into one, in unity, peace, faith, or calling, and hope. Lord, hear us. We pray for all religious leaders and those who teach the scriptures, that their guidance inspires the faithful, gladdens the sorrowful, and strengthen the weak. Lord, hear us. We pray for world peace. Father, guide the nations and their leaders into the way of truth and justice and peace. Establish among them that peace which is the fruit of righteousness. Lord, hear us. We pray for the community. Father, teach us to use the resources of the earth to your glory, that all may share in your goodness and praise you for your loving kindness. Lord, hear us. We pray for all those who are sick, the medical teams, the nursing teams, the domestics, and all other caring for us at this time of the pandemic time. We ask that your blessings for safety, strength, and endurance. Father, we place them in your care. Lord, hear us. Father, continue to make us fruitful reapers in your vineyard, gathering souls for you.
Thank you, Hetty. And so let's gather up all our prayers together as we pray the prayer that our Savior, Jesus Christ, taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. And as we think of the many things that God has given us, let us count our blessings by singing this song, I'm Counting Every Blessing.
I was blind, now I'm seeing in color. I was dead, now I'm living forever. I had failed, but you were my redeemer. I've been blessed beyond all measure. I was lost, now I'm found by the Father. I've been changed from a ruined treasure. I've been given a hope and a future. I've been blessed beyond all measure. I am counting every blessing, counting every blessing, letting go and trusting when I cannot see. I am counting every blessing, counting every blessing, surely every season you are good to me.
And the blessing. The Spirit of truth lead you into all truth. Give you grace to confess that Jesus Christ is Lord and strengthen you to proclaim the word and works of God, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.